Good morning. I'd like to welcome all of you to Bainbridge United Methodist Church, those of you who are here in person, as well as those who are online and those who will be joining us later online. It's a pleasure to have each and every one of you here. Really do seeing everybody's faces on this beautiful day and also seeing the hits and stuff online. That's really good that we're getting out there. Happy Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day to, you don't have to say that back. It doesn't work. Isn't it amazing how you do that? Hey, happy Mother's Day. Dang it, can't do that. I want to say happy Mother's Day to all of you who are mothers and also everyone who has acted in that capacity throughout your lives to someone. In our announcements today, first off, I want to remind you that we have a Bible study on Mark each Wednesday at 7. We're only 2 weeks in, so feel free to join us. I think, have we made it to chapter 2 yet? I don't think so. No, I think chapter 2 starts this week, maybe. We're just kind of seeing how it goes. We may take a pause for summer, we may take a pause here and there, but generally speaking, it's just a very relaxed time studying the Word of God. So it's been very interesting as well. So please feel free to join us. I want to remind you that on May 18th, we have a district meeting. Everyone is invited. It is this coming Saturday at 11 o'clock at the Stillwater Event Conference Center, which I'm not sure where that is, but that's where it is. If you want, there's information I have. There's also information out on the welcome table. Where is it? Oh, okay. So there's information. I have the information if you're interested. There's also information back on the welcome table. And that is in preparation for our annual conference, which is May 29th through June 1st this year. It is in Bexley at Capital University. Myself and Missy will be attending both of those. Again, the district meeting's open to anyone. I think the conference is too, but you can't vote. What I am planning on doing is, I'm sure each and every one of you have heard about various things that have happened within the United Methodist Church with the general conference that occurred. Those two meetings will be a lot of information on what has occurred and, more importantly, how it is that we are going forward. So I would ask that you guys just hold off. I'm trying to gather what I can. And then on June 23rd, we are going to have a meeting after church, right after service. And I will give to you my understanding, my knowledge, what I have learned about all the changes or not that have occurred at General Conference. Again, my guess is Bainbridge United Methodist Church will not notice hardly any difference whatsoever. But I do want to gather that information and bring it to you. Lastly, when it comes to General Conference, we have a collection, and I don't have my collection list up here, but there's a collection going on so that we can take to General Conference. The collection bin is out in the foyer area right before you get to the steps. If you bring, I think it's like cleaning products and some other stuff, the list is out there. So if you want to bring those, again, we will take those towards the end of the month to General Conference. That is all the announcements I have this morning. Our call to worship will be overhead. It's Acts 1, 6 through 14. Read in unison, please. Then they gathered around him and asked him, Lord, are you at this time to restore the kingdom to Israel? He said to them, it is not for you to know the times, the dates, the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive the power when the Holy Spirit comes on you.
Amen.
mentioned it's also Ascension Sunday, so we are celebrating Jesus's return to the Father before he comes back to us as well. Please stand if you are able for our worship music this morning. Amen. Please be seated. If the kids could come up, please. And if somebody, Jace, why did I put my hand over? Jace. Or, thank you, sir. What you got there? Cool. Like a lizard or something? Oh, that's cool. How are you guys doing this morning? Where's everybody else? Hello. All right. What are we celebrating today? Mother's Day. So, people who, we celebrate Mother's Day. What is it that moms or women who have acted like moms, aunts, friends, stuff like that, what is it that they do for us? Help us? Give us clothes, okay? Anybody else? Give us what you need, right? What else? What else do moms or people that act like moms do? Yeah. They'd be nice to you, right? They teach you stuff?
Yeah.
Teach you stuff? Do they love you?
Yeah.
How do they express that love? What do they do?
Hugs,
right? Again, the giving stuff, yeah.
Shelter,
yeah. Put a roof over your head, right? Yeah.
Food.
Food's good, right? Food's good.
Sometimes.
What, meaning you don't like all food? Yeah, me neither. Hey. So, the interesting thing about what women who act like mothers or who are in that motherly role do for us is they give us things that last throughout our lives. Do you ever think about that? I'm sure you guys have already had times where your mom has said something to you or an aunt or a friend, something like that, and then later on you're going, oh man, they were right. I should have listened. Right? Right? Am I the only one? I'm the only person that's ever happened that had happened to? No? All right. Thank you, Jace. I appreciate it. Everybody else is like, no, I'm an angel. I get it. I got it. So all these things that they teach us and they show us and the way they act with us, that gets in, it becomes a part of us. And it grows inside of us. And then what you will find is as you get older, and especially once you get into adulthood and start having your own kids, you will start finding that the way they treated you is the way you treat your own kids. And more than once you will be, I can't believe I'm acting like that. So that's what we do. It's always a good thing. So today, what you guys are going to do at the end of service, anybody tell you about these yet?
No.
Okay. So we are going to hand out, and by we I mean you guys, are going to hand out these seed packets with little flowers on them to all the women today. And what this represents is how they help us to grow, both as people, but also how they help us to grow in faith. That's what today's sermon is about, is how we grow in faith through the contributions of women in our lives. So you're going to hand out these seed packets as everyone leaves so that they can be reminded that these little seeds turn into big flowers, and that's what happens in each and every one of our lives with the women that are in them. Pretty cool, huh? All right, let's pray. Lord God, we thank you. Lord, we thank you how it is that you use the people in our lives to plant those seeds. How you plant those seeds that grow in us as we learn more about you, as we experience the world, or just that wisdom that comes into us through our women, mothers, aunts, and others. Lord, I pray that these young children listen to those seeds of wisdom, listen to those seeds of faith that get planted in them. Lord, I pray that the women that are in their lives cultivate them, and also that you cultivate them. Lord, we thank you for all these things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, thanks, folks. As we move into our prayer time this morning, I want to remind you that the basket for prayer request is up here now, but it is back in the table by the offering plate. You can put a prayer request in it, and each Sunday we will bring it to the altar. And if it is a public prayer request, it will go into the insert that's on the welcome table as well, and you can pray for that or have people pray for that through the coming weeks. If it's a private prayer request, it'll come to just me, and I will pray for it throughout the week as well. So I want to remind you of that. Also want to remind you how it is that you can give to the church. You can give in the plate, you can give online, and then also you can mail it into the church if you would like. Your giving, your tithing, your generosity to this church helps us to do this. Helps us to be here, helps us to do mission into the community, and just helps us try to show Jesus to the community and those around us. Let us pray. Lord God in heaven, Lord, we come before you humbled. Lord, this beautiful day you have given us, Lord, pales in comparison to your grace. Lord, this day shows us how wonderful of a creation you have made. Lord, we thank you for that. We thank you how it is that you show up in our lives, how you show up in the people around us, how you show up in the mothers, the aunts, the other women, and also in the guys. Lord, we thank you how it is that you indwell in us and that you interact with the world and you interact with us, both yourself and through each other. Lord, we lift up all of the goings-on in the world. Lord, this world is in trouble. We know that. You have told us such in your word, that it will be in trouble until you return. Lord, but we ask your intervention in all things. The actions of the world, the actions of this country, the actions of this state, and Lord, just in the actions of us, guiding each of us, each of the leaders in your way. Lord, let your Holy Spirit, let Christ, let yourself just guide each and every one of us as we go throughout our lives. Lord, we lift up everything to you from the beginning to the end as we pray that prayer that your Son taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please stand if you are able for our song of preparation. Be seated. Our call to worship this morning comes from our scripture this morning comes from Romans 16, 1 through 7. I commend you to our sister Phoebe, a deacon of the Church of Shinchura. I ask you to receive her in the Lord in a way worthy of his people and to give her any help she may need from you, for she has been the benefactor of many people, including me. Greet Priscilla and Aquila, my co-workers in Jesus Christ. They risk their lives for me. Not only I, but all the churches of the Gentiles are grateful to them. Greet also the church that meets at their house. Greet my dear friend Apinus, who was the first convert to Christ in the province of Asia. Greet Mary, who worked very hard. Greet Andronicus and Junia, my fellow Jews, who have been in prison with me. They are outstanding among the apostles, and they were in Christ before I was. The word of God for the people of God. So if you haven't noticed, I'm like stumbling over my words today, so this isn't good for a preacher, so bear with me, not sure what's going on. I actually slept in for 20 minutes this morning, maybe I shouldn't have done that. So today we're celebrating two things. First, we're celebrating Ascension Sunday, when the risen Christ, in physical form, returned to the Father. And he will be there with the Father until his return to this earth, to right this earth with all of creation with its creator. And of course, we're also celebrating Mother's Day. And for this, we are not celebrating not only mothers, but I want to look at how it is that women have made a huge contribution to faith. We celebrate the Ascension as a celebration of victory over death. And it is an anticipatory example, a way to look forward to Jesus coming again. But also that Christ in physical form left us only to leave the Holy Spirit with us. And next week we get to celebrate Pentecost. Kind of one of my favorites. I really like the Holy Spirit. And in celebrating the women today, we are going to celebrate how they have impacted our faith. We celebrate those in the scripture who did the work of God, who followed the calling of God in their lives, and how it is that even though they may not have realized it, they were impacting generations in the world. These two themes may not seem as though they go together. And quite frankly, I kind of toiled over it this week. I'm like, how do I put these two things together? They're both kind of important, but how do I put them together? And then it hit me. Mother Teresa. Mother Teresa was a nun, but yet she was called Mother. Why? This is how my ADHD brain works, okay? Just bear with me. I'm thinking about Mother Teresa. She's called Mother. Why is she called Mother? She's a nun, right? So I started looking it up. Well, the order of nuns, or a missionary work of nuns, the head nun is called Mother. Why? And I started thinking about it. Because clearly didn't have children, so why would they call her that? It's the role she plays. It's the role that head nun plays. The role of nurturing, the role of protecting, role of guiding, role of teaching. A motherly role, if you will. And this role was played out in women, or through women, in Scripture, and is also played out in each one of our individual lives. So let's first go old school. Let's go all the way back to the OT, the Old Testament. In seminary, you start abbreviating stuff OT and NT because you get tired of typing it out. So, the OT. I'm not going to go through every woman in the Old Testament who played a part in bringing the faith that we know today. That's way too many. Unfortunately, sorry guys, we get way too much credit in the Old Testament. Well, throughout history, really, largely. Women were there too. Women did a huge part. No, it was no different in the Old Testament. But rather than going through every woman in the Old Testament who played a part in bringing our faith, I want to focus on four. I want to focus on four women of the Old Testament. And the reason I want to focus on these four is really because of the New Testament. You see, when you read Matthew 1:1, Matthew 1:1 is the lineage of Jesus. The lineage of Jesus is something I used to try to punish, correct my youth groups with. Because if you've ever read it, it is really long and it has words that are just impossible, or not words, names that are impossible to say. So I used to tell them, they keep acting up, we're going to start reading that. But aside from that, what's interesting is you have this really long first chapter of Matthew that goes over the lineage of Christ, the bloodline of Christ. In all of this bloodline, there are four women of the Old Testament mentioned. There's also Mary, but she's New Testament. Four women of the Old Testament. And these four are Tamara, Rahab, Ruth, and Bathsheba. You see, God chose not only men, but women in the bloodline of Christ. So let's look at what these four, who these four were, and why it is that they might be included. Tamar was the daughter-in-law of Judah, who was a son of Jacob and the grandson of Abraham. Tamar deceived Judah into having relations, and she became pregnant with two sons, one of whom became in the line of Christ. Rahab, whose woman has always been followed by her occupation, that of a harlot, Rahab lied to authorities to protect the Israelites, to protect their spies. And then in Hebrews, the writer referred to her as a woman of faith in the God of Israel. Ruth, a Moabite woman, not Jewish, the daughter of a relationship between Lot and one of his daughters. Ruth was a Moabite woman who married Boaz, a Jewish man, who became David's great-grandmother. Bathsheba, she is always identified as Uriah's wife, and after her and David's adultery, David married Bathsheba, and they birthed another son named Solomon, who was in the direct lineage of Jesus. Now, these women alone tell us so much about Christ. Quite frankly, I was reading this going, wow, this is a sermon all to itself, which we're not going to get into today. Because when you look at it, it shows that Jesus came for all people, wasn't just for the Jewish people. And that Jesus didn't come just for the perfect people, because those in his lineage were not perfect. But the focus today is on the bloodline and how God included in Christ's bloodline women, something that was not done in that day. Then we get to the New Testament. First and foremost, Mary, the mother of Christ. Mary nurtured Jesus throughout his life. And she was there when Jesus died on the cross. Jesus caring for her by passing off his caretaking of her to John on the cross. There were women among Jesus' disciples. We often concentrate on only 12 disciples, but in reality, there could have been up to 100. We don't know. We know there were the 12 main ones, but there were many others. And if you read through the New Testament and you read about Jesus' mission, there were many women as his benefactors. Many women who helped finance, who helped take care of Jesus and all of his disciples. Then we get to the empty tomb. Now there is some confusion about exactly which women were at the empty tomb, because there's a whole lot of Marys named when we're talking about the empty tomb. So I started trying to figure out which one's which, and it was unclear. The one thing that was abundantly clear is that at the empty tomb, the first ones to find that Jesus had been resurrected, that Jesus was not there, were women. Specifically, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Christ, were there. And it was Mary Magdalene that, upon finding the empty tomb, ran to tell the disciples that Christ had risen. A spreading of the good news, a telling of the gospel. The first time the gospel was told was by Mary Magdalene. It was Mary Magdalene who recognized the risen Christ, mistaking him for a gardener at first until he spoke. And then we get to today's scripture. Paul, being one of the most prolific writers of the New Testament, a man who said of himself he was a Jew among Jews, had a woman carry his message of good news. There is only one passage in the entirety of Paul's writings that is contradictory to how he acted. There's a passage in, I think it's Corinthians, one of the Corinthians, that talks about women should be silent in church. That is contradictory to everything else that Paul wrote, particularly this letter in Romans. Many scholars can't reconcile this. As a matter of fact, one of my favorite scholars, I heard him say once in a podcast that when he gets to heaven, one of the first things he's going to ask is Paul going, "What did you mean by that? Because it didn't make sense." But I digress. Romans is Paul's longest letter. It was written while he was in Corinth. It was written to a group of Christians that he had not met yet. He hadn't been to Rome at that time. Romans was written somewhere either 57 or 58 AD. And this was before any of the Gospels that we have today. Mark, the earliest of the Gospel, is estimated to have been written somewhere around 60 AD, maybe slightly before, but either way, the gospel itself was not well known. So you have Paul writing this letter to the church in Rome who he had never met, introducing himself and introducing the theology, introducing the revelation that God had given him about what Christ meant for the world and what it meant to be a follower of Christ. Romans is arguably the deepest theological work of Paul, where when you read Romans, you really get into what God had given him. So you have Paul's one of most important letters written to people he had never met. And I want to remind us that we're not talking about sending a text or an email or even 30 years ago when you would write a letter, put it in an envelope, and put a stamp on it, and put it in a mailbox. A letter was not that easy back then. First off, it wasn't easy to write because not a whole lot of people wrote. Secondly, it wasn't that easy to get it from one place to another. If you were going to write a letter, you had to commission it to be sent there. You had to commission that letter to go to wherever it is that you wanted to go. You had to pay for it. In order to do that, you had to have it hand carried. And that journey may take weeks or months, something that wasn't cheap. And when they got there, they had to read the letter. Because the letter got there doesn't mean that whoever the recipient was could read it, especially given the differences in language of the region. So Paul writing this letter was a big deal. So when you wrote a letter in those days, you would commission somebody to carry it for you. And that person carrying the letter would be with you either as you wrote it or you would explain to them what it meant. So they would read the letter before they left and see this, okay, what did you mean here? All right, and explain. So they understood what that message of the letter meant so that they could explain it to whoever it was that they were going to read it to later. that letter carrier would know what it was said and what the intent was behind it. And the letter carrier in those days was almost exclusively male. So you have one of Paul's most important letters, introducing himself to people he had never met, written before any of the known gospels, introducing his theology, the theology that Christ or God had given him, being carried by a woman. This was the point of our scripture today. Paul chose Phoebe, a woman, to carry his letter to the Romans, to read his letter spreading the gospel, the good news of Christ, and to explain what he wrote, preaching and teaching what it was that he said. This was revolutionary at the time. This shows how Paul understood that the spreading of the gospel wasn't reserved for men. This shows how Paul understood that women played an important role in the spreading of our faith. You see, women have that nurturing ability. Now, guys, I know we have it too. We do. I've always had this thing of this role between men and women. We can all play each role. But today we're focusing on how women nurture, how women protect, how women teach, how women have spread, have put that seed in us, and then help it to grow. The pieces that women plant in us that live with us throughout our lives long after they are gone. Mothers, aunts, teachers, Sunday school teachers. Anytime a woman or a man takes an interest in helping to shape us, to shape our lives or shape our faith, planting that seed of Christ inside of us and helping it to grow. So on this Ascension Sunday, on this Mother's Day, we can see how it is that what is given to us, we take it in. It is nurtured, it is grown within us, and is there within us long after whoever gave it to us is gone. Christ gave us the Holy Spirit. Women help us to grow in faith. Christ left us in that physical form, but remains with us, just as everything that women have done throughout the faith and our own personal lives that help bring us to where we are today. Amen. As we come to that time of communion, this is a gift that Christ also gave to us, a gift that is with us despite Christ no longer being with us in physical form. Let us pray. Lord God, we come before you with thanks. We thank you for this gift, the gift of your Son, but also the gift of this communion. This communion that will help us to grow. Lord, we ask for the forgiveness of our sins. We ask for the forgiveness of those times that we have not followed your desires, but followed our own. Lord, and we thank you for the ability to turn back to you. Lord, we ask for your forgiveness in all things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This gift of communion was shared with Jesus' disciples. Today we share it with each other. And while they were eating, Jesus took the bread. He broke it, gave thanks for it, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you." Then he took the cup, blessed it, gave thanks for it, and said, "Take, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood poured out for the forgiveness of sin." Holy Spirit, we call upon you. We call upon you to make these gifts of bread and juice into the body and blood of Christ. Let it nourish our spirits. Let it nourish our minds. Lord, let it nourish us so that we may be a beacon for you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We practice open table, which means whether this is your first time or your 50th year time, you may partake in the gift of communion. This will be by intention. You will come down. I will give you a piece of bread. You will dip it into the juice and take the communion, asking that you don't do the entire hand dunk for the sake of everybody else. And I will try to give you a large enough piece of Jesus so that you don't have to do that. But let us serve the musicians, and then I will open the table. Please stand if you're able for our final hymn. Whether you're 5 or 80, we can always see how people enter into our lives, plant that seed of faith, and it grows within us. I pray that this week, the Holy Spirit, Christ, God Himself, reveals more to you so that you may plant the seed of faith in those around you. Whether it's intentional or just through your own actions, I pray that the Holy Spirit act in you this week. Lord God in heaven, we thank you. We thank you for your Son. We thank you for your Spirit. We thank you for you. We thank you how you take that mustard seed within us and grow it into an enormous amount of faith. In Jesus' name, and all God's children said, amen. Happy Mother's Day, church.